So Jessica asked me to come for a couple. I kept this all very formal. As a scientist, I like slides, but that's okay. I'll just talk a lot with my hands, which I also do. To talk a little bit about the research, and really, I'm open to doing, you know, to talking about whatever you're interested in. She said people are interested in the research that was going on, and I can tell you, if any of you guys know Sherry Masofsky, who's the outreach coordinator at our university, she has nice little packets that I have here for you that tell about the different studies that are going on now, and also who to contact. So we have two outreach coordinators. So if you have any interest in research, by the way, at the university, we have this Movement Disorders Research Registry. Anyone can sign up for that, including people, spouses, or anybody who doesn't have Parkinson's, because sometimes when we're doing studies, we need people with and without those movement disorders. So anyone can sign up for this. It doesn't obligate you to anyone, to anything, but what it does is it allows us, allows researchers to contact you if there might be a study that they think you might qualify for to see if you're interested in. So you're not signing up for anything other than the ability for someone to contact you, because obviously, because of privacy rules, people just can't find you and contact you. So anyone who's interested in that, it's there. My background is, I've always been, as a researcher, interested in trying to figure out what are the very first things that go wrong to cause Parkinson's disease. So we know, and many of you have heard about this, but we know what Parkinson's looks like in the brain. If we look in people's cells, we know, you might have heard of Lewy bodies, which are these kind of clumps that contain a protein called synuclein. And we know that happens, and we know those brain cells die over time. But the big question has, in my mind, has been, what causes that to start? Because as you know, if you've been living with this, we have a lot of good medicines to treat symptoms of Parkinson's disease. But other than exercise, which I'm a huge fan of, that's the only thing we have right now that has been shown to probably slow this disease. And right now, I'm excited about a lot of these studies because really for the first time over the last couple of years, I'd say we're getting to where we're testing medicines that are aimed at slowing the progression. One of the things that I study is called mitochondria. For those of you who have a science background, you've probably heard of that. Some of you may not know. These are actually really cool organelles inside all of our cells. We have a lot of them, and they actually are descendants from bacteria that somehow evolved to live inside our cells. They have their own little DNA, and they basically are responsible for all the energy. For producing all the energy in the cell, and brain cells in particular require a lot of energy, and they don't replicate, and so they really rely on mitochondria. And there's been a lot of evidence that those mitochondria might be the very first thing that goes wrong. And that started back, some of you may know Dr. Tim Greenemeyer from the university as well. Actually, when he was a postdoctoral fellow, he discovered that if you inhibit mitochondria just a little bit in every cell of the entire body of a rat, they develop Parkinson's disease, even though every cell is affected the same way. So that was one of the first hints. And then, since then, there have been a lot of studies, so a lot of the genetic causes of Parkinson's disease work on mitochondria. So there's a lot of evidence that that mitochondria are important. So that's kind of what I spend my time studying in the lab for the first 15 years. Now I'm doing studies that are taking that information. We suspect there's mitochondrial dysfunction early. And in fact, if we look at autopsy tissue of people who have donated brain tissue, we see that this one component of mitochondria in particular, the same component that Greenemeyer's model affected, we see that those brains are lacking in that activity a little bit. But we've never been able to look early on in people because we don't have a way of looking at that mitochondrial activity in the brain. So the studies I've been doing more recently are looking at new imaging techniques that can actually look at that. So I had a study, I would have told you